Welcome back to show number 5 of On Your Computer with Kevin Gleason. I'm often asked to explain cut and paste. Actually, cut and paste, and copy and paste are the most frequently used requests on most computers. Let's examine the differences between each of these operations on both the PC and the Macintosh computers. Each operation has some commonality, as you will see as we move over to the computers. I am working with the Windows 7 operating system. Windows has two word processors available as part of its standard system, WordPad and Notepad. Notepad is a no-frills word processor that allows very simple text editing, but does not offer features like bold facing nor word wrap, as text will be displayed in one very long line until you press the Enter key. If WordPad is not on your desktop, it will be found by clicking the Start button in the lower left corner, then clicking All Programs, scrolling to Accessories, and then clicking WordPad. WordPad does have an abbreviated band across the top of its page called the ribbon. The ribbon allows the clipboard, font, paragraph, insert, and simple editing operations. WordPad also has formal margins and does provide word wrap when the line extends into the margin area, it is returned to the following line. The flashing vertical line is called the insertion pointer, where the next character typed will appear. Cut and paste implies different operations. A cut removes text from the screen. A move implies that text taken from its original location will be pasted elsewhere, whereas a copy leaves the text in its original location while pasting text elsewhere. Where does this cut or copied text go? It is placed into a buffer, which is an area of computer memory used for short-term storage. Text in the buffer must be used before it is overwritten or while the computer is turned on. Although some programs have cut and paste listed in their edit menus, this tutorial will teach the hotkey method. A hotkey consists of a special key and character combination that replaces the click to open a menu, then the click to select a command, which can be much slower, especially if you have an older style computer with an uncooperative mouse. Begin by entering the text. Now is the time for all good citizens to come to the aid of their country. The first step is called selecting the text. We select text to inform the computer of an upcoming operation on that text. Hold down on the left mouse button while dragging the mouse through that line, highlighting the characters beneath. Next, cut the text by holding down on the Control key, that's the CTRL key, while pressing the letter X. Think of X as in extract. The text is removed. We can retrieve that line by holding down on the Control key while pressing the letter V. Think of the V as in retrieve. The text is returned to its original point. The selected text is still in the buffer for continued use, but in this tutorial, let's select it again to move it this time with Control X. Move the insertion point down the page and then hold down on Control and press the letter V. The selected text is cleared now and returned to its original location in this document. This time do a copy by selecting the text again, but pressing Ctrl-C. Think of C as in copy. Move the insertion point to the end of the line and press Ctrl-V. To retrieve this text several more times. This again is a copy operation. To end this example, click X in the upper right corner, and if asked, do you want to save changes to this document, click Don't Save. Knowing the method to cut and paste is only a part of your goal, unless you can use it in some practical manner. Here in this example, you're in the process of writing a paper using text edit. The paper is entitled Chapter 7, The Use of Technology in Medicine. You've written the introduction and now you want to continue with the topic of robotics in healthcare, but you want material that is from current relevant articles to appear. So highlight the text Robotics in Healthcare by pressing and holding the left mouse button and dragging over the selected text. On the Mac, holding down the Command key while pressing the letter C. Now this will copy the selected text to the buffer. Next, open the Internet browser. Then clicking the search area once to put the insertion pointer up there. Press the Command key and hold that down and press the letter V to retrieve the selected text from the buffer. Then press Enter. Immediately we find 10 medical robots that could change healthcare. Click on that link. There appears to be one of 12 sections here. Select the text for the entire column and press Command-C. Move the mouse pointer back to the word processor until it becomes an insertion pointer again. Then press Enter a couple of times to separate the paragraphs. Then press Command and V to retrieve the material from the buffer. And inside of a minute, we have the makings of a paper about robotics in medicine. We hope you will be able to put this material to good use. We will now visit a user group that meets weekly in Cambridge near Harvard Square, where they refurbish donated computers for families in need.
The organization we work with is Solutions at Work, and this particular program is called Get Connected. And we place a really strong emphasis on education, helping people learn how to take care of their own systems. And we met up with Solutions at Work, which was started more than 20 years ago in order to help people with very low incomes or in difficult times in their lives to get into the workforce. One of our goals is to make this a good work training opportunity. So we go out of our way to welcome people from different walks of life, including people who are going through a life crisis of some kind. The only requirement is that you come and you be serious about participating, and that you be serious about being friends with people here. This is a group of people who want to get to know each other and want to support each other and help get these computers ready. We have a large number of computers that were donated. A lot of them were donated by companies, and some are donated by private individuals. And we store them in a closet, and then we bring them out to this public space. This is a space that the old Cambridge Baptist Church courteously lets us use on Wednesday evenings for this purpose. And we set out, as you can see, we set up these computers on this table. Space them, set them up with monitors and mice and the like, connect them to the internet. Our wonderful neighbor, Spare Change, shares their internet connection with us, the Spare Change newspaper for the Homeless Empowerment Project. and we then get these machines on the internet, and then we go through a very rigorous set of steps to take the machine from having a blank hard drive to being a machine ready for families with for families who have children.
Mm-hmm. Now, do you perform any kind of a wiping operation with the hard drives?
Or? I'm glad you asked that. So the corporate donations, corporations by law in general, Massachusetts has a very tough data safety law. Mm-hmm. So by law, almost all corporations, with very few exceptions, are required to erase their drives before they get them to us, which is a huge time saver for us. It makes our life a lot easier. Private donations, what we try to do is we teach the private donor to wipe the machine before it even comes to the church, which we think is the very safest way of taking care of that problem.
Mm-hmm. So this is a low-level format?
No, it's we usually recommend, when we teach people to do it, we usually recommend a freeware program called DBAN, which it stands for Derek's Boot and Nuke. You boot and you nuke. And it wipes the drive very effectively. And although it doesn't have fancy certifications, it's very well respected by the security community, so we feel comfortable using it. So we start with a completely blank hard drive, and then most of the machines we get have licenses that were purchased with the original machine. Mm-hmm. The license sticker is on the machine, and so we obtain the appropriate disk and then install using that license number so that we're keeping in, we're very strict about keeping in compliance with the software regulations and the licensing regulations.
Excellent. So right now, are you doing something of a triage to check and see what each machine needs to have done to it, or is that something that...
It is kind of part of the process. So as we set up the machine, we turn it on and we see where we are. Mm-hmm. We do keep a chart. We use actually a Google spreadsheet to keep a checklist for each machine. Mm-hmm. So each machine is a row in the spreadsheet.
What all is involved for a person that wants to come down and volunteer?
I often describe this as a pickup basketball game. So we basically invite people to come on Wednesdays between 4 and 7. We get started at 3:30 and we close our doors at 7:30. So usually 4 and 7 is the best time to come. Mm-hmm. To come and participate in the whole process and in whatever time frame works for you. If someone only can make 15 minutes, we've had people who've been able to do that and they've gotten good things out of it. And then we have some people who stay from the beginning to the end. It depends on what works for people. We have some people who are religious about coming every week, which I think is a wonderful way of being. And then there's some people who just can't do that, but they can come sometimes and they're very welcome as well.
Typically, what kind of a background would you expect somebody to have? Must they be an electrical engineer or?
We have a whole range of volunteers from people who have almost never touched a computer in their lives. To people who have advanced degrees in electrical engineering and computer science. And the range is really wonderful. So people help each other, and there are people who don't have fancy degrees but know a lot about different things. And I find that every volunteer contributes something. We had a volunteer that had amazing organizational skills and helped us begin to get our closet act together. And so we really are eagerly welcome anyone to participate.
When a machine leaves here, does it have anything besides the operating system software?
Yes. So as I mentioned, we have a procedure that's, I think it's between 60 and 80 steps, where we take the machine through its paces, mm-hmm. Starting with checking for any major problems, recording them and dealing with them. For example, a backplate might be missing as a minor problem, or there's a showstopper, there's no hard drive in the machine. We get through those issues, and then we install the operating system according to the sticker that came with the machine. We sometimes have XP machines, sometimes Vista machines. A few Windows 7 machines have made it to us.
How would a typical family get a machine?
There are a lot of different ways. The tradition in this program was that we would be contacted by an agency representing a person. Mm-hmm. So if you were either a person who has no place to live or a person who has serious job problems, serious unemployment problems, or serious health problems, you'd go to a social worker or an organization like Lyft Communities or one of the many other social service agencies that are in Boston. And then your social worker would call us and say, this person needs a computer. And then so that's basically the official way this happens. Get connected, may I help you? Hi. Good, how are you? I'm Adam. I'm the coordinator of the program. We refurbish desktops. and we can make them available to your clients. They cost $50, a money order of $50. And we're open on Wednesdays from 4 to 7.
This project has had so many layers, and it's felt like so such a positive experience at so many different levels. So it is both providing computers to people who haven't had them, but it's also, unlike a lot of, I've been very disappointed by some efforts to get computers into the hands of people who don't have them. Often there's not proper support and maintenance, or the computer gives more trouble than it's worth. What I like about this program for people is that we're really here on an ongoing basis. So computers are not, they're like gardens. They need to be tended.
Exactly.
And you can't just take a computer and give it to somebody and say, good luck. And so we have made a really, I think one thing I really love about this program is that we have a really long-term commitment to make these computers available, to be there when people have trouble, and to learn from our mistakes. It's inevitable when you work on a project. It took us a year to develop this routine of how to handle these machines appropriately. There's been a lot of working through of issues, and that's been very satisfying. It's been very educational. I think that's the second thing. One of the other things I really love about this program is that it's such a great learning opportunity. I've been working with computers for more than 20 years, and I learn something every week here. There's something new. It's increased my confidence. It's made me a better computer practitioner. It also is a really nice teaching and learning opportunity for people who are newer to the field, and to learn different ways that people learn. I also find that it's a wonderful social opportunity, because the activity is absorbing and difficult, but it's loose enough, and we're not under huge time pressure usually. It's loose enough so that people can get to know each other and spend time with each other and joke with each other and give each other a hard time and all the things that make for a really good community. I also think that it's given us a chance to think a bit about how computers get used in our culture. And I think that this is a nice opportunity to do some experimentation. We've tried different kinds of software. We've dealt with virus issues. We deal seriously with privacy issues. It's also a really nice opportunity to think about how we help people who are in distress. I think that this is an area where our culture sometimes really falls down. And my own personal experience and observational experience is one of the best ways of helping someone in distress is to welcome them into your working group. Because there's nothing like doing something worthwhile to pull somebody out of whatever crap they're going through and to do something good. And to do it on an ongoing basis where people are going to feel welcomed and supported. And so that's made this project particularly wonderful.
Great. We will now visit a user group that meets in Natick, Massachusetts, once a month to demonstrate and promote free software.
We started the group a year and a half ago. Mm-hmm. And we started it because there is nothing like it that we could find in between Boston and Worcester. Kind of like every town to have at least one group like this. We talk about the free software that the stores don't talk about because they can't make money selling free software. There's a lot of it out there. So we thought there was a need to let people know it exists, and after that, to build the confidence to try some of it and to use it well. Mm-hmm. It's very easy to learn from what your friends are using. But jump-starting is harder. We want to jump-start a lot of friends using very good stuff.
I imagine there's an awful lot of similarity between the free software as well as the products such as the Microsoft Office.
Well, free software covers the entire range, mm-hmm. from absolute uninformed beginner level trying to do something that doesn't complete and doesn't work well yet, and things that are better than what you can buy commercially, things that are running 95% of the world's supercomputers, things that run inside your wristwatch. At every level, the open source free software can be more than totally competitive, or it can be a dud, or it can be something good that's a bad fit. So selecting between 100,000 choices for the ones that are good and a good fit is a lot of what our group is about.
Now, do you also support the Windows world?
Unix has been out there longer than Windows.
Yeah.
But you didn't buy a computer and bring it home with Unix on it. And you wouldn't have liked it that much if you were an amateur user. You had to learn at somebody's elbow, I think, to do it easily back then.
Exactly.
Linux is, in essence, free Unix. and it's Linux rather than the more classic Unix that's running most of the servers, most of the smartphones. It's called Android. Mm-hmm. Most of those other things I mentioned, or that you could imagine. It's gotten very slick, and we never, in our personal experience range, used Mac OS X. A lot of people do, we don't. Nothing against it. In fact, it's a Unix-like system, also derived from Unix, mm-hmm. and also derived from free open source software that Apple modified for its use. Google kept its free, but also modified it for its use, Android. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of Linux out there in drag, looking like something else. The version we happen to specialize in is called Ubuntu Linux, and it's one of the most popular ones. And we think it has advantages and disadvantages, but it's the one we choose of many. And we help other people make other choices when they have some particular reason to do so. Our user group is not limited to any one kind of Linux, and it also has many things we do that work equally well with Windows and with Mac OS X. So some of the programs run right across the board on all of them. Mm-hmm. Firefox, for example, a very popular web browser, runs on any of them. So if we're talking about Firefox, everybody fits. If we're talking about the world's greatest photo processor program for your average user, it's not Photoshop. That's $500 and very prohibitive to learn and much too complicated and big to be useful for most users. We use Photox, only Linux for Photox. So some yes, some no. Some of it fits everybody. Some of it, until you're doing a free open source operating system as well, you can't get in the door for some of the better corners.
Now, in working with Linux, do you notice either viruses written to access Linux to try and violate?
Yes, but almost none. Way under 1/1000th the amount that you'll find with Windows. Mm-hmm. Mac, really Unix, including Mac, as I said, and Linux, and BSD, and a bunch of other things, relatively virus-free. Windows, very virus-rich. And Windows, in addition, simply because it's the big target out there, mm-hmm. aside from the technical reasons it's been a good target, it's just a big target, so a lot of people aim at it. So we get a lot less virus to worry about. So much so that my computer runs faster for not having to do virus scanning. My email.
Now, for people coming to your user group, do you require any previous skills?
Well, we do expect that you have a computer or know where to go borrow a computer mm-hmm. to practice on, and maybe to load some of this onto, so you might need some permissions on the computer. If at a library, for instance, you may not be allowed on the regular computers to try a new kind of software. Mm-hmm. But providing you can load a program onto the computer, we'll show you how. It's easy. Some of them aren't easy, but most of them are. Depends on the level of depth at which it resides. We have experts and we have beginners in our group. Mm-hmm. And we like the mix, try to encourage the mix, and want the beginners to, after a while, feel like they're expert at some early step and they can demonstrate it. And we want the experts to feel like they're beginners about half the time on what we do, because otherwise it won't interest them too much.
Exactly.
And we want those experts to kibitz, to jump right in and to add something.
Let me ask if somebody would, someone from one of the neighboring towns wanted to come to this senior center, is there a restriction? Must you be a native resident?
The only restriction I'm aware of for coming in, and this is a free group, is if you're an infant, don't come without your parents. We'd like to get more high school students, as a matter of fact, in this group. Mm-hmm. We know that they and what we're doing would be a great match. We've had some of that activity, but not on a regular basis.
The Natick FOSS assumes that you have Linux installed on your computer. If you would like to explore the Linux operating system on your computer, you might consider attending an Install Fest. Install Fests occur several times a year, where a group of volunteers assemble to help you switch your computer to a flavor of Linux, or, in some cases, to run Linux as a virtual machine inside of your existing operating system. This allows you to switch between your current operating system and Linux and return again without affecting your current computer. The Boston Linux Unix Users Group runs this function. For more information on upcoming install fests, check out this link. In Boston, another Linux user group meets near Kendall Square in Cambridge. You will find this group to be quite informative for the general and the new user to Linux. They can be reached via the following link. Thank you for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you again next time.